So, yes. Don't they see a black woman working? Y'all see my hair? Yeah. This lighter right here is actually nice. Once again, I'm sorry if you can't see my eyes. My bad. But we not here for all that. I have another video about periods. But now I'm just gonna make a video about like the basics. Okay, things that you should know, things that should be taught. No tea, no shade, no pink lemonade, but things that should be taught to us, things that I feel like I wish I knew when I was younger, and just things that like I want my younger sister to know, I want my daughter to know, my younger cousin to know. I'm gonna be sharing stuff like that. So basically, a period is something that only women can get, or people. Yeah, I'm still learning about pronouns and stuff. Don't cancel me. But women or people with ovaries and uterus. So even if they are transgender, if they still have ovaries and uterus and hormones, they can get a period too. And basically what happens is once a month your period comes, and that's basically where you bleed. Point blank, like simple, you bleed. And you can bleed for like certain, that's another thing, cycles are not the same for everybody. So some people bleed for a whole week, some people bleed for like 3 days, some people bleed for five, and then you do have people who really only bleed for like one or two. So you just, once a month you're bleeding for however many days that's normal to you and that's normal for your body, you're just bleeding. I'll put a picture. You have two ovaries, one on your left side, one on your right side, and then you have your actual like uterus, which is where your walls are, and it basically all connects, right? So to me, I just call it a garden, cause like, it is a garden. It's like a flower. And in your ovaries, you have your eggs. Now, women, we are born with all our eggs. We're in our mother's stomach with all our eggs. So what you're born with, that's forever. But you had to hit a certain level of puberty for your period to come, because when you hit puberty, that's when your hormones start going and it starts telling your brain like, hey, we might want to start dropping some eggs. So once you start getting those hormones, that's when you have your period. And before your period, 2 weeks into your cycle, you ovulate. That is when an egg, basically like your estrogen peaks. So there's estrogen and progesterone. Estrogen is the main hormone that's there for like the first 2 weeks or the first half of your cycle, which is what makes you ovulate. And then progesterone is there the second half of your cycle up until your period actually comes. That's what makes you kind of moody and hormonal and PMS-y, and that's the hormone that comes when you know you're about to get your period. And then when it like peaks and drops and everything comes together, boom, period, right? So ovulation, what happens is, and I say like it tickles, but like your ovaries here, okay, your ovaries here, and then you have like, I don't know what it's called, y'all, but like I said, I'm gonna put a picture, but you have a thing that kind of like tickles, and then it vacuums up an egg. From that point on, this is kind of bad, but from that point on, your egg is going down through your wall, or not through your wall, but through your tube. There it goes. Your egg is going through your tube. It's rolling, rolling, rolling. I can't even roll in peace. But it's rolling, rolling, rolling. And then it comes down to your walls. If you're pregnant, it will meet sperm. Sperm will penetrate it, and then it will come on your wall. It will attach so that that baby, you're pregnant, okay? If you don't have any sperm, it's just gonna come down, down, down. It's not gonna attach. So then your walls fill with blood. I don't wanna say your walls fill with blood, but basically your walls and your lining fills with blood. And then that is what sheds at the end. So, yes. Don't they see a black woman working? Say you have your first period, right? And I'm also gonna start by saying I asked people what they wanted to know or what they wish they knew, and my cousin told me that she wanted to know the meaning behind it. Now Of course, like, you had the science meaning, and then you have, like, theories. But I'm just gonna go both ways. So science theory is just that, like, we carry the kids. Sorry, nature designed it. I don't know. I don't know why they picked us. Probably because we stronger. Probably because we better. Probably because, I mean, look at me. Would you really trust a man carrying a kid? Like, let's really So, we are just the ones that's carrying the kids. I don't know. But because we're the ones carrying the kids, and like I said, you are born with all your eggs, it doesn't matter if you're ready to start baby making or not. You're born with all your eggs, and they're going to start coming out. When you have your period, every time you have your period, an egg actually does come out. It's just that it's so microscopic, you're not going to see it, or it might come out while you pee, or, you know, down the toilet, basically. So, it brings on the period because after ovulation, you can either be pregnant or not pregnant. If you're not pregnant, then that's why you get your period. Because your period is telling you, hey, you're not pregnant. Try again next month. Basically, that's like the science behind it. But my theory is, I feel like we get periods too to help release and to help for us to take like a break. Because I feel like women, there's so many women, especially black women, and black young girls, where we are just running around thinking about, I need to be this, I need to be that. And I feel like your period helps to make you like sit down and go lay down in that bed, sit down and go eat that food that you really want, you know, sit down and take care of yourself. I feel like that's one of my theories is why we also get a period, because it helps, and it not only helps you take care of yourself, but it helps you release emotions and say, like, sometimes I find myself going through things or having emotions during my cycle, and then once my period comes, it's just like a hoo. Like, for some reason, I just feel better. Like, I just let all of that shit out. That's how I kind of see it as too, kind of like a cleansing. So I think that's also why so many women are synced with the moon, because moon cycles also help for you to release. If you know, especially on TikTok, they're always telling you it's a full moon. You need to write down what you want to manifest. You need to write down what you want to let go of. That's also what I see a period as, something that's very magical and witchery. If you know period blood is so strong. I see it as we just got blessed. We just got blessed with a little extra magic. And of course it's hard sometimes, but sometimes magic is hard. Now I wanna get into the hormones, just real quick. Like I said, estrogen is the first half. Estrogen is like, so you guys know everybody has estrogen, testosterone. It's just that women have more estrogen, men have more testosterone. Now, once your period comes, your testosterone increases. That's why you might get a little angry, you know? Because men like to say they're not emotional, but... So yeah, testosterone also does increase right before you get your period, which also is why we get moody. But another thing that you have is progesterone. Progesterone, it just helps to fill your body up, like, with that blood. And let me see though, y'all. I don't want to be giving out false information, so let me read y'all the facts. So I do know estrogen is there the first half of your period. That's what helps you peak, and then you ovulate. And yeah, after ovulation, that's when your progesterone comes in. So, all right, see, now they got with the big words, and I just want a simple, dumb it down for me. Basically, it's saying it's a hormone that's released to help prepare the uterus for pregnancy. So it does increase because after you ovulate, even if you're not having sex or nothing, your body still prepares for a baby. So even after you ovulate, even if you're not having sex or anything, your progesterone still is gonna go up because your body is expecting a baby. It wants a baby. That's why it went through that whole cycle. So once you don't have the baby, then that's when, or when you're not pregnant, that's when it fills with blood. The progesterone helps to fill with blood, but then progesterone also helps for it to come out. Like for your period to come out. It's like a peak in progesterone or a drop. Let me see. Sorry, y'all, I had to re-educate myself. Basically, your progesterone, it increases after ovulation because it's preparing for you to have a baby up in there. Because if you have a baby then, or if you're pregnant, your body will continue to rise in that progesterone to support the baby and everything like that. But if you're not pregnant, then that's when progesterone falls and then your period starts. And then once your period starts, it happens all over again. Your estrogen comes back higher. Then you ovulate. progesterone comes in, boom, period. If you're pregnant, you know, hormones is, every hormone is damn up in that when you're pregnant. So, so now I'm going to talk about differences in flow. So when I say flow, I mean like basically how much blood is coming out. Let's be honest. How much blood is coming out? Some women have a light flow to a moderate to like medium to heavy. If you have a light flow, hold on, let me go get my pads. So if you have a light flow, then that's where, okay. These are the pads that I use. This type of pad is an overnight pad, but I like it because it's big. It's up to 10 hours, I think. You could wear it for like up to 10 hours. And for me, I love doing that during the day because I don't got time to keep going to the bathroom three, 4 hours apart changing pads. But you do have other pads. You have maxi pads. These are thin. So it's just like a thin pad. But you have some pads that's thick, that's like this or so. But on every pad and tampons, now pads are what you stick in your underwear. Tampons is what you actually put up there. I don't wear tampons, so I don't have any, I'm sorry. But basically it's in this applicator. And you put the applicator up inside of you, and then you, it's like a thing underneath. You push that in where the string, it's like the string is there too. You push that in, and then it releases a cotton tampon into your vagina. One thing with tampons I want to say though, tampons are okay. Everything's about preference, so don't judge nobody, don't judge yourself. Whatever you like, that's what you like. But I just want to say that if you have a light flow, tampons might not be the way to go, or if you're like, towards the end of your period, tampons might not be the way to go because for it to come out, because when you take it out, you gotta pull it out. And for it to come out, you kind of want it wet. Okay? Think about sex, think about lubrication. You want the tampon wet so it comes out easier. If you don't have it wet and it doesn't expand and stuff and it's still in there and you dry, it's gonna be very hard to take out and it might even hurt. So use tampons on your more heavy days, and if you have all around light flow, don't use them. I don't want nobody get hurt because this pretty down here. You want to keep her okay, you want to keep her as pain-free as you can. We already go through a lot, and please take them out. I know some women who have had them, not personally though, but you know, you hear stories about women who the tampon just stayed in there. When that tampon stays in there, y'all, you got to think about it. Blood brings bacteria. You don't want that sitting in you, getting brown and rotten. So keep yourself on a schedule. Even if that means you have to put something on your phone to remind you like, hey, it's time to go change your tampon. Hey, it's time to go check on it. Do that. I want to emphasize throughout this whole video, what works for you, works for you. Fuck everybody else and fuck what everybody else got to say. What works for you, works for you. So if you gotta put a reminder, put a reminder. You gotta put something in your bathroom, put it in your bathroom. What works for you, works for you. Okay? And we don't judge no other woman around here who do what they do and wanna do on their period. But when you go to the store, whether it's pads or tampons, it's always going to tell you. So right here it's on the side of mine, where you can kind of see, it tells you when you pick it up, the flows and the days and everything like that, or what size you might want to wear. And then this, it tells you like, this is a size 5. This is the biggest one that they make, because this is the one that I have. Right here is where you'll really see the flow. And me personally, I like having wings on my pads. The wings on your pads are this part here. Wait, is it on here? Yes, the wings on your pads is this part right here. And the wings go underneath your panties. I'm gonna do another video about period hygiene, and I will actually show y'all putting it on your panties and everything, so be patient for that. But I personally love wings because I feel like if I don't have wings, I feel like that pad is switching way and going everywhere. I like wings, I feel like it secures it to my panties because the wings also have stickies on it, so it sticks to the underside of your panties so that it really stays. So I like wings, but they also make some without wings. If you don't If you like the ones without wings, like I said, ain't nobody judging. Do you? But if you like wings, make sure it has wings and it'll say it on it, like flexing wings or something. So, purple. And one thing that you'll learn is that with pads and tampons, they're color coded. So purple normally means like the heaviest kind of thing. Purple and orange normally mean heavy and kind of like overnight. Then you have your green and your yellow, which means those are they're shorter on your panties, and you also only wear them for no more than 4 hours. So that's like the ones if you're going to school and stuff like that. But I don't like those. I get these because them little ones, you gonna leak. Depending how heavy, you gonna leak, okay? Depending on your flow, you just gotta look and try. Don't be afraid to try out different pads, try out different tampons. There's also Diva cups. There's also natural pads that people make 100% out of cotton that you can buy, and those are washable, reusable. But yeah, whatever works for you, get it. There's Diva cups. Diva cups is like a cup. You fold it and you put it up there like a tampon, but it's supposed to be more cost effective and better for the environment and better for you because it's not actual cotton going up inside you. It's just plastic, I believe. I believe it's plastic. And that's just going up inside you. You hear it pop and it's just open. It's a cup kind of attached to your walls like this. So when the blood is coming, it just goes into the cup. And then when you're in the shower, you take it out, clean it, everything. I also want to emphasize, like I said, I got a hygiene video coming. But baby, whatever you do, be clean as best as you can. If you use a Diva cup, clean it before and after. And it will always tell you, y'all. Mine says extra heavy overnight. I'm not extra heavy, but like I said, I like using them. I don't leak with these. So, but if you extra heavy and stuff, you have to get extra heavy flow. Because them little pads ain't gonna do nothing for you, baby. And it's okay. It's okay if you have a heavy flow. I want you guys to know every flow is different. You can have light, you can have heavy. And every cycle can be a different flow too. You can have one cycle that's light, next cycle is a little heavier, next cycle is back light. Like, you know, it changes. But overall, you should have a general idea of how it is. Like I said, you have light, moderate, then kind of like regular, and then like heavy. And then you do have some women who have super heavy periods. Part of flows and talking about flows, I want you guys to know all flows are pretty normal unless you are very, very heavy. Like I said, I'll get into reasons for that. But if you're very, very heavy, definitely see a doctor. If you're having a very, very heavy period, this is blood you're losing. So you have to be careful. When you're losing blood, you know, you're losing iron, you're losing a little bit of nutrients and stuff. It all comes out with your blood. So if you're having a very, very heavy flow, oh, and I'm sorry, I didn't even tell y'all. A very heavy flow is where you're kind of filling up like a pad in like an hour or two. And I'm talking about filling. As in, you go to the bathroom in the next 2 hours and boom, this shit already filled. And it's filled, or you could be having big blood clots. That's a very heavy period, and that's what you want to consult for. And I want you to know whether your period is light or heavy, it is all okay. You are fine, you are normal, you're just a woman. But yeah, I want you guys to know when you first get your period, it can be heavy. It can be heavy. Some teenagers, they start very light, and then it gets heavier. Some teenagers start off the bat heavy. Ooh, and that's okay, like I said, that's okay. But if you are filling up pads, you need to consult a doctor. Basically, you hear a lot about how these pads and tampons aren't the best for us, and I agree they aren't, but hey, listen. You go to the store, you buy them, you pop them on. Hey, it is what it is, okay? If you get like a cotton type of pad, they might be a little more expensive. Not too much though, but just a little more. But those are still reusable. You gotta remember that too. Cotton pads, they're reusable. I'm not sure if they have, and I'm talking about 100% organic type of cotton pad. Tampons, I'm not sure if they make those. I believe they do, but they're not reusable. But they do make 100% organic tampons. Cups, like I said, they're plastic, so pretty much you put it in, take it out, and you could keep reusing that. Just make sure you clean it. Boil it in water. Boil it and wash it, okay? Don't be having it. Wash it and put it up in a way. I never tried the cup before. The cups run for about $30, but like I said, they last for like a year or two or some shit like that, so it's a good investment for your money, especially if you're getting a period every month type shit. So, yeah. And then free flowing is basically where some women, they be just basic, like they free flow literally. So they be on their period, but they just be flowing. No pads, no tampons, just vibes. I just saw that on TikTok one time, so I figured I'd talk about it. I don't know if there's like a science or a practice behind that. I don't know. You would have to look it up. That's what free flowing is. No pads, no tampons, no nothing. You just letting it all come out and you just being you, like we in the cave times. That's free flowing. And when it comes to pads, tampons, and everything, like I keep saying, it's all your per what you prefer, what you like. Test, try, don't be afraid to. This is something that you gotta live with until you're damn near 50. So now I wanna talk about discharge and smells. So when you're going throughout your period, you're gonna have, or throughout your cycle, you're gonna have different types of discharge. So at first you might have like a white discharge and it's kind of creamy, I guess, but thick, like not thick, but thicker. Like it's white, and say you went up there and you could take it off, it would just be like this. And it would kind of look like cottage cheese, but not in the sense of a yeast infection. Like obviously you're not gonna be itching and it's not gonna be in abundance, but you might have a little bit, it might look a little bit like, I don't even wanna say cheese, cause it's not cheese, but it's just discharge. You know, it's white, that doesn't smell though. That's just your body telling you that you're not fertile. So at that time, if you were to have sex and stuff, you couldn't get pregnant because that's your discharge telling you, hey, you're not fertile, do what you wanna do, get it popping. So that's what that's telling you. Once you ovulate, you'll get a thicker and a more slippery and clear discharge. It will be like an egg white, it will be thick, you pick it up and it will expand. Like normally with the white creamy one, if you go like this, you know, it's not doing nothing. But this other discharge is going kind of like a yo-yo, it's going, you know? It's gonna be thick and it's gonna be slippery and clear. That's your body telling you, hey, I'm ready to make a baby. We getting into it. And sorry, y'all, that still won't really have a smell. Or some women do smell while they ovulate, but it's not like a bad smell. It's just a, you know, because when you ovulate, not only is that your body telling you, but if you have a man, or you know, nature like wants us to make a baby at that time, so it lets off a smell that sometimes men can smell or that you can smell, and that's just the smell of you ovulating, because what that smell does, men kind of get attracted and then they kind of want to, you know, they might want to make a baby. So that's why it might smell, but it shouldn't smell bad or nothing, but you might have a little smell, but that's just you. And that smell shouldn't be like a big smell where everybody can smell it and stuff. No, it might just be you plop down, wiped after you peed, and you could just smell, you smell a little sweetness. Maybe that's just you ovulating. You might have a little smell with that. And after you ovulate, it'll go back down to that white discharge. It's sticky. Oh yeah, there it goes. It's sticky. So it's gonna be white discharge again, and that's just your body saying, okay, we back, not fertile no more. And the reason why your ovulation discharge is thick and slippery is because basically that's the discharge on your cervix. So before your vagina, you have your cervix. That's where sperm enters. If you get a pap smear, that's what they check and everything like that. If you get an IUD, they're going in your cervix before your uterus. Your cervix is like a hole before going into your actual uterus. So your cervix, what happens is, at first, you know, when you're not fertile or when your body doesn't want a baby, that's just your cervix saying, okay, like whatever. And it will have that thicker, creamy, sticky discharge because that's it blocking. It kind of blocks sperm from going in a sense. So like, imagine you have like imagine your cervix just has a wall around it, right? And that wall is the discharge. At first, that wall gonna be strong and thick. It's gonna be like, no, it's not time. But then as your cervix and your hormones change, now that discharge is gonna change because it's gonna be more slippery, so it's easier for sperm to get through, right through your cervix. So Other than that, that sticky white discharge helps for sperm not to get in there as easily. That's another reason why it's there, and that's another reason why it's telling you you're not fertile. When I first was getting my period though, y'all, I didn't have no discharge. So I just want to say, if you don't have discharge, like, not that it's normal, but it's okay. I didn't have discharge at first, like, but then again, I did have irregular periods. If you're having a regular period though, you should be getting discharge, or your body should be letting you know somehow, some way, these different changes in your cycle. If you have an irregular period, it might be a little different where you might not be able to tell. And that's perfectly okay, because if you go back to that video, I have herbs and stuff that you can take. Once you get closer to your period, the discharge, you might not have any discharge at all. And that's just because your body is now getting ready to have your period. So once that happens, there still shouldn't be too much of a smell. But like I said, every woman has a smell. Every woman smells how she smells, and you should be used to how you smell. Get to know yourself down there so that you know, and that way if something is off, you can smell it, and you know, like, this ain't how I normally smell. Like, don't be afraid to really, it's your body. So I don't want to be TMI, but at the same time, I want to be very transparent for young women. So I'm gonna say, stick a finger up there, and get to know yourself. Like, stick a finger up there and look at what your discharge, how it comes back out on your finger. Get used to that. Look at what's like, I don't know how to explain it, but look at how it looks for you. Smell it, see how it smells for you. Oh, this, it smells off. Oh no, maybe this is how I just naturally smell. You know, if you have a bad smell, it smell like fish, or, you know, sometimes your period, it might smell a little bit like blood or iron. If it's smelling like rotten blood or iron, that's a concern. But every woman has a smell. It happens. It's nature. Don't nobody really give a fuck. And if somebody got a problem with it, the fuck, then you ask them what you smell like. But get to know yourself. Stick a finger up there. Or if you, sometimes the discharge will come on your panties too. You know, I'm not gonna lie, I be all up in that shit. Let me see. Okay, you look like this. Let me smell it. You smell like this. Okay, you smelling like on track. You smelling right. Okay, good. Do it. You're a woman. This is stuff, like I said, until 50, until menopause, this is what you're gonna be going through. Know yourself. Don't be afraid to stick a finger out there, see what it's looking like, and get to know yourself and smell it. You know, just wash your hands after, or do it before you take a shower, or, you know. And I ain't afraid to tell my sister or anybody who asked me, what your panties look like? Put a finger up there, what it looked like. You need to know. So, and if you're having a smell or you're itchy down there, sometimes when you're really, really itchy, it'll be a yeast infection, and you'll have an increase in discharge. Those are natural, y'all. It's okay. Everybody done had a yeast infection before, I promise you. And yeast infections sometimes have a smell, sometimes don't, but there would be an increase in discharge and itchiness. Now, BV has a smell. BV is just a bacteria imbalance, basically. Down at your vagina, you have a pH balance. A pH balance as in acidic to, what's the other side? Acidic to the other side or whatever. I believe vaginas are pretty acidic. They range higher on the acid. Let me look it up. But yeah, it ranks higher. It's not the most acidic, but it ranks with moderate insane acidic. So every woman has a pH balance, and when it's out of balance, like, sometimes more bad bacteria might build up. Then that's when you might get a smell. It might smell like fish, or you might smell off. And most of the times with BV, it's a noticeable smell. So if you smell like fish, let's be honest, if you ever smell like fish, or you ever smell all down there, it's okay. Understand, just because you smell like fish, that don't mean like you're dirty and you should be embarrassed about it. Like, no, everybody has had BV before, and sometimes you can have BV and it won't smell. And you won't even know unless you just know something's off type shit. But if you smell like fish, you have a smell down there, you're itchy down there, don't be embarrassed, baby. Just go to a doctor, go to a practitioner, talk to a trusted woman in your life, and just say, you know, I smell fishy. Because most of the time it's gonna be BV, and with BV it's a simple fix. They give you an antibiotic, they'll give you some medicine. You can even use some boric acid that you can just buy at the store, put it up there, and just get, and it will just basically make your levels back balanced. Nothing to be embarrassed about.